Amen. It's Happy Mother's Day, but my wife started talking about something that happened to us, dear Lord, back in 1985, I think. I got put on as an associate pastor at Rock Creek Foursquare, just across the freeway, or I was just about ready to. And we were in church one day, and I was doing a Sunday school class, and this guy walks through the front doors and comes, and he's about as far as from that wall back there, and he's just looking at me, and he and I look at each other, and it's like, I'd never seen him before, but it's like we were friends or something. It's like God just did something. And he came in, and we chatted, and afterwards I found out he was a missionary. They'd just gotten back from Africa. Huh? Yeah, Lebanon. I think everybody's a missionary to Africa. But it was from Lebanon, and he had his wife and three kids, and they'd gotten back from Lebanon like in December or something like that, months ago, and God told them to come back, and they had been going through the United States. They went down to Texas, and they were in Arkansas. They were going all over. They had rented an RV, and they were going all over because God had put somebody on their mind, and they didn't know who it was. And so they were going to different churches around. They were missionaries. And he said when he came in that door and saw me, he knew that I was the one that God had put on his heart to come and see. And is that wild or what? And so we were feeding them. We didn't have any money. I don't think I was on as an associate pastor then, just about. And I didn't get laid off. I was a log truck driver, and some days there just ain't any work. And when my wife said Jesus, she wasn't cussing. She said something about Jesus. It sounded like she was cussing, but she wasn't. But anyway, we had that deal, and the people were showing up, and she's feeding them. And we left one day, and we had about that much soup she was making in a pot. That's all we had. And we went out to do something. We came back, and the pot was full. It had been simmering. And God just multiplied everything to us. But one night, the guy and I were sitting in the living room, and we're having tea. And he just looks at me and says, well, what's it going to take for you to serve God and do what he's called you to do? And I didn't want to say, well, we're too poor to do anything. So I made up some other excuse to why I couldn't do it at that time. And I'm sharing this because what I want you to get, this is Mother's Day, we'll talk about Mother's Day, but this is important because God is as big as you are close to him. I love Mount Hood. From out here, Mount Hood is small. I like it, but it's out there. But I've climbed Mount Hood, climbed almost to the top of it, and it's big. And my point is the closer you get to God, you get to God. How many know Mount Hood never moves? In order for it to get bigger, I have to go to it. God is about the same. If he's going to get big in your life, you have to move to him. You can stay at a distance and it would look like all that God stuff is just foolishness and who cares and why bother. But the closer you get to him, the more real he becomes. And we were getting closer to God, closer to God. And so this guy, and I'd been to 1 year at Rhema, so I'd been saved maybe three years. And so this guy, we're sitting in the living room again, we're drinking our tea. And he asked me the same question. He says, what's it going to take for you to serve God and do what he's called you to do? And I said, because of the situation, I felt like just telling the truth. I said, we don't have enough money to do anything for God. And he pulls out a check. Now, back in October, November, whenever it was, I don't remember the dates, I'm really crummy at that, I was hauling logs down by Newport, down 101. And I was believing God for finances. I was believing God that our bills were paid off, believing God that all our bills were met and everything. And I'll never forget this. I was heading south of Newport on 101, and I was praying that, confessing that. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, the money's coming. It's on its way. And I don't remember what the date was, what the month was exactly. I'm just terrible at that. Never have been good at that. But it's okay. I remember the story. This guy begins to tell a story how he and his family were in Lebanon by Tyre and Sidon, and they had just had they'd just been bombed, and his kids were running around outside, and there was shrapnel all around his kids, but each kid looked like somebody had a metal umbrella or something over each kid, and nothing fell on his three kids outside. And he went in and he got his kids together and went inside and he looked at the calendar, and God told him that he needed to leave Israel on this certain date, which was just a couple of days later, and put somebody on his heart. He didn't know who it was. And so they left Israel as missionaries, and they rented an RV, a little tiny RV, and they just began traveling from, they came in New York or someplace, began traveling around the country, down to Texas, down, you know, all between there and Texas, just stopping at churches and seeing if whoever God was trying to get them to meet would show up. And he said, when I walked in, I knew you were the one that God sent me from Israel to come and meet. We started talking, and when God told him to leave was exactly the same date that I was praying, and God said, the money's coming, it's on its way. And he had a check in his hand that God had told him to give me that paid off all of our debts, all of our credit cards. Y'all out there? And he just handed it to me. And the next day, he and I went and paid off all of our stuff, and we had $6.13 left. What? $5? No, $6.13. She's the mama. She thinks she knows it all. But I mean, the point I'm making is when you seek God and you draw closer to God, then he does the impossible for you. Amen. I mean, that story is good. The fact that he multiplied the pancake batter is good. The fact that he multiplied the soup or the stew, whatever she was cooking, is good. But the greatest thing is he loves me. Amen. He loves you. And he's willing to do any of that for you if you draw close to him. Amen. If you continue to stay back from him, it'll be like there is no God. It'll be like, well, why doesn't he help me? And his thing will be, well, why don't you seek me? Why don't you draw near to me, and then I'll draw near to you? Because, see, he's not gonna interfere with your free will to be stupid. He isn't. He gave you a free will, and he's not going to do anything against your free will. You can do whatever you want. Act any way you want. He'll still love you, but you're not going to necessarily walk with it or in the blessing that he's got for you. Amen? But I'll tell you what, the time you start drawing closer to him, I mean, when I got on top of Mount Hood, it looked bigger than it does from here. When I got closer to God, he did more for me than he's ever done when I was away from him. Amen. Amen. I mean, how'd you like to have a guy just hand you a check that takes care of all your bills, and he was sent by God the same day that God spoke to you and said, the money's coming, it's on its way, and that guy and his family just left Israel, came seeking us out, and paid off all our bills. And then it wasn't too much longer that the pastor asked me to be the associate pastor at the Rock Creek Foursquare. Amen. What a coincidence. I wonder if God had anything to do with that, or if it was just luck. Sorry to get carried away with that, but when my wife started on the story, I just can't stay away from the whole thing, because God's good. Y'all out there, God's amazing. Amen. But happy Mother's Day to all the mamas. Amen. I mean, I'm glad I've got my wife. How many of you had a mama? Anybody not have one? Praise God. That was a good thing then. Bless the Lord. It's just a good thing that men don't have to give birth, because there wouldn't be any people left. Because that'd be the end of that. Amen. But how many know moms are devoted and they're dedicated to their families? Man, I don't know. I watch my wife and I watch my daughter and watch a lot of the ladies in the church. And man, women are so dedicated to families. I mean, guys, we'll give up on them. Like, you're too stupid. Just go away for a while. But mamas, they hug and love, and I'm thinking, just smack them. But mamas, they just love them no matter what they do. Y'all out there? I mean, it's so cool to watch a mama who's devoted to the family and dedicated to the family. And mamas don't ever seem to turn on the kids. The kids turn on the mamas. But mamas always seem to love the kids and stick with them. And you know, you moms, I know sometimes you can play with a lot of guilt and think, well, you're not doing a good job, and well, the kids, you know, you get a kid that turns out wrong, and you can start thinking, oh man, I really messed that up. I tell you what, there are a lot of kids that have been brought up with the right stuff who still turned out bad.
Amen.
It ain't the mama's fault. Amen. Sometimes you mamas get to feeling guilty about how your kids are doing, and you know, when they get to be a certain age, they're responsible for themselves.
Yes.
Amen. But I'll tell you, mamas, they put a lot into the kids. Are you out there? And mamas are the ones that hold the household together. I don't know about you, but mamas like to make sure that everything is running good, and that the kids are where they're supposed to be and everything's laid out. My wife, if it's Father's Day, man, I don't have to think about anything. I mean, she's got where we're going to go and what we're going to eat. I mean, she's got it all planned out, and all the kids know about what's going on, and Father's Day shows up, and I get to be happy father, you know, and Christmas shows up. She's got everything all taken care of. Easter shows up, and all the food is ready. Mother's Day shows up, and she takes the day off, and we're all going, doesn't she have anything planned? What are we going to do? And so today we finally figured out maybe we'll go to a certain restaurant and see if they have room, because we didn't plan for anything for Mother's Day. But mamas don't do that. They know in advance if the place is open. They know in advance if there's room for you. But her husband and her kids don't do those kind of things all the time. Amen. But how many of you know mamas, they're always taking care of stuff and looking after things and making sure things are working well and working good. I don't know about you, but I appreciate that. Amen. And how many of you know that mamas are the spiritual anchors in a lot of families? I mean, I thank God for the prayers of that woman. In fact, if it weren't for her prayers, I don't know where I'd be. Because my mom wasn't saved. She didn't love Jesus, love God. And my dad didn't. But when God hooked me up with her and she got filled in the Spirit and born again and all that Christian stuff, she began praying for me, because women just hate to see people not serve God. In fact, they can't put up with you if you're not serving God, because you make it difficult on their life. And so she prayed for me. Her and Vivian Ang over there, they prayed for me in 1980, 81, sometime back in there. And because women just care about people. Amen? And I'm so glad they did. Thank God for it. I thank God for all you ladies, all you mothers. I know what you go through sometimes with us guys, and it's a challenge. Bless your hearts. But thank God that you have whatever God put in you to hold families together and to to be spiritual guides for your family. Amen. How many, you know, seeing as how it's Mother's Day, how many guys think it'd be a good idea to get your kids to give a little list of things they love about their mama? And give them a little list, give your mama, give mama a little list of things like that for her to read of how the kids appreciate her blessing. Some mamas would probably appreciate that. Amen. But I was thinking about the Apostle Paul, and you know, the Apostle Paul, he was instrumental for bringing the gospel to the Gentiles. And he was a Hebrew, and he went around killing the Christians and destroying the Christian church. And then God got a hold of him and just changed him. And what I like is that, you know, for most of us guys, not me, but a lot of guys, they think masculinity is how big is the tires on my truck or how big a gun have I got. And for God, masculinity has more to do with how much of the love of God have you got in you. And how do you transfer that to the rest of the world? And I love Paul. We're going to read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, because Paul is going to, I mean, he's a man's man. He's persecuted, in jail, beaten, died one time, but he stayed with God, and God stayed with him, and he was teaching the new Christians. And he demonstrates his love for people. I want you to get this. 1 Thessalonians 2, 7, how the Amplified says, "But we have behaved gently when we were among you, like a devoted mother nursing and cherishing her own children." Paul, the apostle, explains his love for the people like a mother. I mean, how many of you know mothers and babies are inseparable? And I mean, a mama, she cherishes those children. And Paul says, that's how I am with you. And he explains his love for them by relating it to his mother's love. Because everybody knows what a mama's love is like. Everybody knows what a mother's love is like. To be loved by your mama and hugged by your mama, even when you're stupid. And have mama hug you and say, "Honey, that's all right. You know, daddy will come home and beat you later." But he's saying that the emphasis of his gentleness is from motherhood, exemplifying motherhood. I mean, how cool is that to use the image of a mother to explain where your love comes from and how your love is demonstrated? So a lot of macho guys, they don't have any love. And I'll just tell you, Chuck, we're probably going to get into this in the next couple of weeks because God's been really bugging me about this, that we're supposed to walk in a love. It's not like world love. It's like the love of God. And so we'll probably get into that later. But when God wanted to explain or express his own love for his own people, I mean, this is how he explains his love for you. I just love this. This is Isaiah 66:13. He says, this is God talking. He says, "I will comfort you there as a child is comforted by its mother." God says, "I'm going to comfort you just like your mother comforts a child." Because I don't know about you, but I used to think God was like with a club and just going to beat the crud out of me every time I messed up, which was often. And coming to God, you got to realize now he loves us. And he cares about it. He's not trying to beat the crud out of us. He's trying to get his love in us to come out. And he says that you can watch that love demonstrated from a mother. Mothers demonstrate the love of God, but we should too. Amen? Amen. God is good. I think God is good. Praise God. And he says, Paul the Apostle again says this. I love this. 2 Timothy chapter 1. It's almost Mother's Day lunchtime. Verse 3 says, this is Paul the Apostle talking about Timothy, who's a young man that he's trying to rear up and make him who he's supposed to be. He says, "I thank God, whom I serve with pure conscience, as my forefathers did, as without ceasing, and I remember you in my prayers night and day." This is Apostle Paul, a man, talking about praying for somebody. Guys, we need to do more praying for people. Amen. It's not just the woman's job to do the praying, it's the man's job also. And Paul says, that I remember you in my prayers night and day, greatly desiring to see you, being helpful or mindful of your tears, that I may be filled with joy when I call to remembrance, when I call to remembrance your genuine faith that is in you. He's dealing with Timothy. He says, you've got this genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also. And he's saying, I've watched your grandma and I've watched your mom. They got saved and they've just become dynamic. And now they have passed that same thing on to you. Mothers are good at passing on this God stuff to their kids. Amen. Thank you, mothers, because if it wasn't for most moms, most families wouldn't be doing too good. Thank you, mamas. Amen. Are y'all out there? And then in 2 Timothy 3:15, he says this. He says, talking about another situation, he says, that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures. He said, your mom and your grandma taught you from the time you were a kid. You know, my wife and my daughter have the grandbabies. They're 7 and 8 now. Dear Lord, they're growing. But it's so cool to see them, the little girls, with their Bible. And they didn't get that from Netflix. They got it from mama and they got it from grandma. Because one thing they're always encouraged to do is to have their Bibles open. Amen. Read their Bibles in the morning. Right? Amen. And mamas do that. Mamas are good at that. Thank you, mamas. I can see you're encouraged. Amen. One more. Romans 16:13. He's talking about a fellow that he led to the Lord. His name is Rufus. And Rufus means red. I wouldn't want that name. But he says, he's writing this letter, and he said, greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord. Watch this. Greet Rufus, chosen of the Lord, and his mother and mine. Paul is saying that this mother of Rufus acted like his mother. Man, I don't know about you, but that's pretty cool. Because a lot of mothers, they become mamas to anybody that shows up. Amen. And they do a good job. I remember back when I was long-haul truck driving, and it must have been right around 1980, and Buddy and I, we drove together, and we were getting ready to head to Texas or someplace, and it was in the winter, and we both had colds. Before I got born again, saved. And so I went to his house to pick him up so we could go get our truck and take off. And so I went to the house, and his mom and his dad are there. And his mom says, no, come on in here. And my buddy and I were both. And, you know, I'm like 29 or 30 years old. Well, I'm 30 years old. Dear Lord. I mean, I'm a man. And his mom, she says, now you guys sit down. And she cuts up a bunch of garlic and says, you need to eat this raw garlic before you take off. It'll help you get over those colds. You see the mother thing going on? I mean, we're 30 years old. I'm 30 years old. I don't know how old he was. And she's still mommying. Take your garlic and you take this before you go long-haul truck driving on the big roads. It's like, we're not six, but we did it. You know, women have this thing that they will take care of you. They'll be your mama till you're 70. Eat your garlic, son. Amen. But I just want to say thank you to the mamas, because you guys do a wonderful job. Amen. Let me give you a couple short stories. There's a little boy in Sunday school, and he's doing a presentation. And his mom is sitting on the front row, just excited about what he's going to do. And he can't remember his lines. He forgets what he's supposed to be saying. And his mother's going, ah. And he's like, and finally she goes, he is the light of the world. And the little boy goes, my mom is the light of the world. Amen. Whoa, don't go there. Don't do that. Here's the 23rd Psalm of a child. Okay, you ready? You ever heard the 23rd Psalm? My mom is my shepherd, I shall not want. She makes me lie down under cool, downy comforters. She watches me play beside the still waters. She restores my soul. She leads me in paths of respect, responsibility, and goodness, for I am her namesake. Yea, even though I walk past monsters in the dark, I will not be scared, because my mom is always near me. Her hands and her voice comfort me. Mama sets the table and cheerfully calls me to dinner, even in front of big, mean bullies. She anoints my skinned knees and broken heart with kisses. She smiles and throws me a towel when my cup runs over. Surely goodness and peace, power and mercy shall uphold me all the days of my life, for my mother taught me to dwell in the house of God forever. Amen. There's a Spanish proverb that says this, an ounce of mother is worth a ton of priest. How you like that? Amen. Watch this. This is Abraham Lincoln. You ever hear him? I mean, the man did quite a bit, right? He says, no man is poor who has a godly mother. All that I am or ever hope to be, I owe to my angel mother. I remember my mother's prayers, and they have always followed me. They have clung to me all of my life. That's the President of the United States declaring the goodness of his mother and her prayers. Washington, George Washington, ever hear him? George Washington said, my mother was the most beautiful woman I ever saw. All I am, I owe to my mother. I attribute all my success in life to the moral, intellectual, and physical education I received from her. If I could just be honest, not every mother is perfect. But neither are we. Amen? And you mamas, don't feel bad if you're not perfect. Just believe God, trust God, and keep on moving. Amen? And kids, respect your moms. Help them. I got one last one for you. Actually, I got 17, but I'm going to do one more. This is called the meanest mother in the world. I want you to listen to this. The meanest mother in the world. It says, we had the meanest mother in the world. While other kids ate candy for breakfast, we had to have cereal, eggs, and toast. When others had Pepsi and a Twinkie for lunch, we had to eat sandwiches. And you can guess, our mother fixed us dinner that was different than the other kids had too. Mother insisted, I want you all to pay attention to this. Mother insisted on knowing where we were at all times. You know, when our kids were growing up, we didn't let them go sleep over at other people's houses. Those kids could come and stay at our house, but not trusting our kids with somebody else. You would think we were convicts in a prison. She had to know who our friends were and what we were doing with them. That's good parenting right there. She insisted that if we said we would be gone for an hour, we would be gone for an hour or less. We were ashamed to admit it, but she had the nerve to break the child labor laws by making us work. We had to wash the dishes, make the beds, learn to cook, y'all listening? Vacuum the floor, do laundry, and all sorts of cruel jobs. I think she would lay awake at night thinking of more things for us to do. She always insisted on us telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. By the time we were teenagers, she could read our minds, and life was really tough. She wouldn't let our friends just honk the horn when they drove up. They had to come up to the door so she could meet them. This is good stuff, you guys. While everyone else could date when they were 12 or 13, we had to wait until we were 16. I would suggest 25 or 30 because in watching people, most people don't even begin to mature until 30. Because of our mother, we missed out on lots of things other kids experienced. None of us have ever been caught shoplifting, vandalizing others' property, or ever arrested for any crime. It was all her fault. We never got drunk, never took up smoking, never stayed out all night, or a million other things other kids did. Sundays were reserved for church, and we never missed once. We knew better than to ask to spend the night with a friend on Saturday night. Now that we have left home, we are all God-fearing, educated, honest adults. We are doing our best to be mean parents, just like our mom was. The world just doesn't have enough mean moms anymore. Amen. Moms, we love you. Be as mean as you can be. Can I get all the moms to stand up, please? I want all of you to know how loved you are and how appreciated you are, how valuable you are, and that there's no replacement for you and your family. You're a blessing from God. God loves you, cares for you, and so do we. Could I have the rest of you stand up and put your hands on these moms? Just put a hand on them. Father, we just lift up these mothers right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you for your grace upon them. We thank you, Father, for your wisdom, your insight. We thank you, Lord, that you strengthen them and encourage them. And Father, that you help them through every tough time. But Father, I thank you, Lord, that they understand how appreciated they are, how loved they are. And Father, that they get back the goodness that they give. They get back the love that they give out. And Father, that they realize that they are valuable to you, that you demonstrate your way of loving to that of a mother's. That's how valuable and important they are. And Father, I just bless them right now in Jesus' name. I bless them in the name of Jesus with your insight and your goodness. And I thank you for each and every one of them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give them a hug if they belong to you. And guys, would you try and tell your wife on more than a yearly basis that you love her, that she's valuable, and that you care about her. Amen. Can you do it? Mamas, I hope you have a great Mother's Day. God bless you. We love you. See you next week for Women's Conference.